My name is Bram Nauta, and I would like to teach you a little bit about n-path filters. I'm from the University of Twente, the Netherlands. N-path filters is based on a very old idea. It comes from 1947, where bandpass filters were proposed by using a down converter, a low pass filter, and an up converter. And this way, you basically receive one little channel and that you transmit again. And this behaves like a narrow bandpass filter. This was published already in 1947. Later in the 1960s, n-path filters became popular, which is in fact a sliced version of this down converter, filter, and up converter. But now there's not just one or two, but there are n of these paths. So the operation works as follows. There's always one of these switches, S11 and S12. They are closed, so one path is conducting, then the next path is conducting, and then the next path is conducting. So there's always one path conducting, and this way the whole branch of low-pass filters works as if it were a bandpass filter. An implementation can be very simple. If we have this circuit with n of these low-pass filters, we can just replace all the low-pass filters by their simple RC low-pass equivalent, like here. And then we can realize that there's always one of the resistors is always connected. So we can as well take the resistor out and just put the resistor here. And now the resistor is always there as if it were in the figure above. And now we can save resistors. If you now look at the output in fact always looks at one of the capacitors. It connects to C1, C2, C3. But this connection switch is also here. So if this one is closed, this one is also closed. So we can as well take this point as the output. So we remove the second set of switches and then we get this circuit. We have the input here and the output is right after the resistor. And the output is sampling all those capacitors as if it were on the right side of this. So this works as if it were an n-path filter like this. So you may intuitively wonder, how does this work as a bandpass filter? And for that reason, I would like to explain things in the time domain. Let's take this topology. And now, to make things easier, I just made it a bit more complex. I put n as 8. So instead of 4 paths, I now take 8. But it's easier to understand this way. And I connect the input signal right here at this side of the resistor. There is a resistor here. And these are the 8 switches, and they are connected to 8 capacitors. And suppose now that the input frequency is exactly equal to my clock frequency. So if I take the clock with all the phases, so at the moment this switch is closed, that is during this time interval. When this switch is closed, that's during this time interval. And the input signal fits exactly on 8 of those little intervals. So the clock frequency is equal to the input frequency. And this way, this capacitor is looking at this part of the sine wave, the red part of the sine wave, and it's charging the capacitor through this resistor. The next phase, this next capacitor is looking at the blue part of the sine wave and is charging that part of the capacitor, and so forth. The idea is that this RC time constant, so this resistor and this capacitor, is huge. This time constant is orders of magnitude larger than the switching period that the switch is closed. So the capacitor wants to charge, but it's only a little bit of charging because there's way not enough time to charge the capacitor. So it just charges a little bit, and at the moment the switches are open, it just waits, and then the next period it just charges a little bit more because it looks at the same part of the sine wave. And then after many periods of settling, maybe 1 million or 1,000 periods, finally the DC value at this capacitor is equal to the average voltage of this red part of the sine wave. So if I take the average, that's the value of the voltage stored. And this happens for all these capacitors. So this way, on all these capacitors, we see the DC voltages stored that belong to the average of the sine wave. It looks a bit like a digital oscilloscope picture of your sine wave. And then the output is in fact this node. And the output is looking at all these DC voltages. So the output is in fact a staircase approximation of my sine wave. And you can see the bigger the n, like the more capacitors and the more phases, the better the approximation will be. So the better it looks like this sine wave. If now the input signal is not equal to the clock, it's just another frequency, slightly different, for example, then during the charging here, we look at this part of the sine wave. But the next time, we look at a completely different part of the sine wave. And since this settling is so very slow, after many, many periods, the average will just be zero. Because first it goes up, then it goes down. it will just stay in the middle because it's so slow. So after many periods of settling with the signal not equal to the clock, we get DC voltages, which are all equal on the capacitors. And that means the output signal is zero. There is no output signal. So for frequencies equal to clock, we get the same signal coming out. And for other frequencies, we don't get anything out. So this behaves like an ideal bandpass filter. What happens is, in fact, is that we have a low-pass to bandpass transformation. This is the RC low-pass filter that we used as a building block with a bandwidth 1 over 2 pi RC. And that filter is now upconverted around the clock with a bandwidth equal to this. And you see here the factor n coming, and that is because we have all these capacitors here, but each capacitor only sees this resistor 1/n of the time. So it looks like the resistor is n times bigger, and that's why this bandwidth is n times smaller. The quality factor is extremely high, because the quality factor is defined as a center frequency over the bandwidth. The center frequency is dictated by a clock, it can be gigahertz, and the bandwidth of the RC network can be megahertz or even kilohertz. So this way we can make a queue of 1,000 without having any physical limitation. And if we fill in the math, we get this equation here for the queue. And you can see if f clock is big and n is big, you can make an incredibly high quality factor. So this is quite interesting. So what we have is an extremely high quality factor. It's the RC bandwidth over the clock frequency, as I just said. It's completely tunable with the clock, so you can really tune it from a few hundred megahertz to a few gigahertz. And it fits into modern CMOS technology because it has only switches and capacitors. There are some other good properties which I will just touch on the surface here. The noise is also good because in band there are no DC currents possible through the capacitors because they are DC. And that means in band the noise becomes really low. You can show that the noise factor is equal to the insertion loss of the filter, which is very close to 0 dB if you have enough phases. The linearity is also good because in band the switches see only small voltages because they only look at the little differences between the stored DC voltages and the signals of the sine wave. And out of band the signals are already filtered, they are attenuated. So also the linearity in band and out band is fundamentally good. And the power is just needed to drive the switches. And this scales with technology. There are some problems. One is harmonic responses, and another one is frequency falling, because it's all discrete time. If we insert 2 times the clock frequency, we see here we have the same 8 phases, but now we have 2 sine waves at the input. You see that, again, the input signals really fit into this picture, and there will result some DC voltages, like the colors here. And that means also the second harmonic is also filtered. It looks like a filter around the second harmonic of the clock. If we insert the third harmonic of the clock frequency, we also get static voltages. So every harmonic fits in. So as a result, we see not only a response around the clock frequency, but also around the second, the third, and the fourth, and the fifth, etc. We get a lot of responses. The signals are a bit smaller because the amplitude of the reconstructed sine wave is a bit smaller, but still there are many filters. There are many filter responses. We can solve something in a differential version. We can save capacitors. So we can do the same filter with 4 capacitors by reusing them. So we can say, let's take this red capacitor, we use it here with the plus and the minus, and half a period later, we flip it. We put it upside down, so the plus and the minus is flipped, and then we make this signal over here. And this signal is equal to minus this signal. So we can reuse this capacitor. We could do the same for the blue one. We put it here, and we invert it here. So this way, we can save capacitors. But there's another nice feature. If we now insert the double frequency, like here, it's drawn, then the blue one first is high here, and it's low here for the first harmonic. But for the second harmonic, it's supposed to be high. So this way, the second harmonic is just rejected. It doesn't come out of the filter. So by making a differential version, all the even harmonic responses are rejected. And if you then look at the frequency domain, you see indeed that the second and the fourth and the sixth, they are gone by just going differential. There is another problem. It's folding. In fact, we have a clock frequency with 8 little phases, but it looks like we are basically sampling with 8 times f clock. And if you know from A to D converter, if this is the clock, then you get folding. It's the whole Nyquist effect. So the frequencies around the seventh harmonic, they will fall back to the first. And also from the ninth, they will fall back. So any signal present at the seventh and the ninth harmonic, they will fall back into the filter. So you need some anti-aliasing filter before that, just like A to D converters. But the effective sample rate is n times f clock. So if you choose n big, that can be okay. So far, I assumed an ideal switch, and we get this frequency response. If we have an on resistor of the switch, then we don't attenuate completely, but there is a finite attenuation, and it's set by the voltage divider by R on over R plus R on, where R is this resistor over here. So you typically get, if this is 50 ohm, this is 5 ohms, you typically get 20 dB of attenuation. You can also make a continuous time equivalent model. So this n-path filter with the R and the switch capacitors, we can replace the switch capacitors with this network. It's an RLC network. And the components are given over here. And they are just a function of N, R, and C. So there's no parasitics over here. And you can see that the bigger the N is, the larger this resistor is, and the better it behaves like an ideal LC tank. If you take this continuous time model and we plot it versus frequency, we get the solid line over here. And if you use the real discrete time simulations, then we get the dashed line. So you see that around the center frequency of the filter, you get a very good approximation of this ideal LC tank. Around the third and the fifth harmonics, of course, this doesn't model it well. We did our first experiment on the input impedance of a mixer first receiver that we published before at ISSCC. We just used the input impedance of the circuit because this mixer first receiver inherently had an n-path filter inside, although we did not know it was an n-path filter at the moment of designing the chip. So we took the existing chip, it behaves like a differential four-path n-path filter. We put the input signal here, this is the R, it's the input with the transformer, and we just measure the input voltage here, and that should work a bit like the bandpass filter. So this is the first way we could show that it really works. And here you see it working. You see it really filters. You can tune it from 100 MHz to roughly 1 GHz. The attenuation was about 20 dB because of the effect of the on resistor. And this is the this is the way we could demonstrate that n-path filters work in modern technology. Around a few weeks later, also another author from Broadcom, Mirzai, independently found this technique and put it in an LNA to filter blockers. So two groups independently worked on this, which is quite interesting. You can also make a notch instead of a bandpass filter. And if you make this LC tank, it works at a notch. It just stops frequencies at the resonating frequency. And then you can make the circuit with 50 ohm in, 50 ohm out, and just a bunch of capacitors and switches, which are timed like this. And then that works as a notch filter. This is the measurements of the single-ended notch. You can see here around the clock, there's the red is the notch over here, but there's a second harmonic and a third harmonic, also notches. You can get rid of them by making a differential, which we also did in the paper. What's interesting is that the insertion loss is here about 2 dB, but the noise figure is also 2 dB. And you can show that the noise figure is roughly equal to the insertion loss, exactly like in passive filters, which is a very nice feature of this circuit. And you can see it's extremely linear. IP3 is close to 20 dBm. And you can tune the frequency. You can tune it here from 100 MHz to 1.2 GHz. It's extremely tunable again. We also built higher order bandpass filters to make a steeper roll-off and to go deeper than the minus 20 dB. And this is a sixth order bandpass filter. It has a resonator over here. It has a resonator over here. And there's one over here. You can do a gyrator synthesis of this filter. And after some iterations, we found this circuit. So we replaced the three resonators by n-path resonators, one here, and one here. Here's a gyrator, which is two back-to-back connected transconductors. And this gyrator we replaced by just one forward GM. This way we could make some gain. That means that the noise of the second part is less relevant. And this backwards GM was not so important anyway in the filters. The GMs are built all with CMOS inverters. So the circuit consists of switches, capacitors, and inverters, all ingredients which are really good for modern nanometer CMOS. This is the chip. It was done in 65 nanometer and published a few years ago at ISSCC. And this is the filter transfer function. The filter could be tuned from 100 MHz up to 1.2 GHz. It has an in-band gain of 20 dB, so it works as an LNA with gain, in fact. and it has a filtering up to like minus 40 dB. So the total attenuation here is around 60 dB, and the bandwidth is only 8 MHz. So it's really a single channel filter at RF, which can be tuned with the clock. And here are some zoom-ins of the bandpass, and you can see that the filter shape remains quite good over all the frequencies. So it's 8 MHz filtering over at gigahertz level. Linearity and noise is also good. The noise figure of the complete filter is 2.8 dB. And the linearity, the IIP3 out of band is in the order of 20 dBm. And in band, it's around minus 10. And the 1 dB compression point is also very good. If we take the filter and we take the measured curve, we get the solid line here. And if we put a blocker only 20 MHz away with a big power of 2.3 dBm, we see only a slight degradation of the filter in the presence of this big blocker, really close to the passband. To summarize, these end-path filters are quite interesting. They can be integrated in scaled CMOS. They are extremely tunable with the clock. You can go to high frequencies, up to a few gigahertz is possible in today's technology. They have good linearity and noise, and they enable integrated channel filtering at RF. But you have to take care of the harmonic responses and volume.